Монгол анхудаа ухаалаг гар утсыг үн төлбөргүй авах урамшууллыг Mobicom дараа төлбөрт Signature вакцин хэрэглэгчдэд санал болгож байна. Та 7-р сарын 9-ний өдрийг хүртэл өөр тойр байрлах Mobicom-ийн салбар дээр хүрэлцэн ирж, үйлчлэгээний гэрээтэйгээр сүүлийн үеийн ухаалаг гар утсыг үнэгүй болон онцгой хөнгөлөлттэй үнээр аваарай. Бидэнтэй хамт байсан хэрэглэгч танд баярлалаа. Mobicom.
Сайн байцгаана уу хүн төлөөчдөө. Өнөөдөр орой манай де-факто нэвтрүүлгийн зочноор бүгд найрамдах Түрк улсаас Монгол улсад суугаа онц бөгөөд бүрэн эрхэд элчин сайд ноён Мурад Карагош оролцож байна. Good evening, sir.
Good evening, Mr. Defacto.
Mr. Defacto. Last year was the 45th anniversary of diplomatic relations establishment between two countries. And you were the ambassador celebrating that with not only people of Turkey or of Mongolia, but all community around the world. How do you find, how do you assess the level of cooperation between two countries today?
So first of all, thank you very much for hosting me tonight. So as you said, that last year was an important year. We celebrated the 45th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between both countries, Turkey and Mongolia, and which gave us an opportunity to make a genuine assessment what has been achieved so far and what needs to be done in the time period ahead. So when, in the retrospective, when I look back, I see that the greatest achievement itself is to establish these diplomatic relations, because during the Cold War we were in different camps. Turkey belonged to NATO and Mongolia was next to the Russia and then the Soviet Union. So despite all this fact, in 1969 we established diplomatic relations. And then of course in 1990 with the democratic revolution in Mongolia, a new opportunity or horizon has arisen between both countries, namely a good friendship and partnership based on contemporary values, I mean democracy, respect for human rights, rule of law, and free market economy. Another achievement itself is the thousands of the graduates of the Mongolian students from the Turkish universities. Another one is the visa-free travel regime, which we achieved last year, and also direct airline linkage between Istanbul and Ulaanbaatar. And also, of course, in the foreign policy concept of Mongolia, Turkey was labeled as the third neighbor. I guess that these are important achievements that we gained so far.
Indeed. Turkey, our third neighbor. And as a third neighbor, we study more closely what is that driving force behind Turkey's achievement for last, in particular, 15 years. A new country which has, not unlike us, a lot of minerals under the ground, and you achieved tremendous success. What is secret behind, do you think?
That's correct. Definitely in the last 15 years we have achieved a lot. In democratization process, in economy, in the social sphere, we really achieved a lot. Number one reason behind was this political stability. Since we entered in the multi-party politics in 1950, there has been many governments, sometimes with one-party governments, sometimes with democratic coalitions were in force. But since 2002, Turkey was able to gain this strong political stability. So that triggered also a courageous step in the field of economy. So since then, the GDP of Turkey has been tripled. So growing rate, the average growing rate has been reached the level of 5.8. Turkey has adopted enormous laws, important law, which allowed also new investment in Turkey in various sectors. Definitely tourism was one of them. And also in the political sphere, we achieved a lot. There were many restrictions in the democratic processes of Turkey. They were abandoned. In the judicial sphere, we achieved a lot. So all in all, taken together with this 13, 14 years in the Turkish democratic history, has been remarkable.
Now, I would like to go a little bit further back. when you had a war after the First World War, long extended war, then civic war, and then that time your leader Atatürk made decisions to convert Arabic letters into Arab letters of Ottoman Empire into Latin. And you are the first sort of countries who was using Arabic letters into Latin. How do you see that move in terms of starting that further democratic and political economic growth in the country?
Of course, 1923 is the milestone in the Turkish history. In that time, I mean, Turkey has been declared as a republic. And Atatürk was the founding father of the republic and has been elected as the first democratic leader of this country. And following that process, I mean, he involved a lot of revolutions. And then what you said with regard to the inscription was one of them. There were many other revolutions with the economy, with the civil war, with the legitimization or legitimate rights of the women, or the moving towards economically strong country, along all those lines. But it will be misleading to delete the past of Turkey, because the modern republic was found or just was the successor of the Ottoman Empire, which lasted 623 years. So based on that background, this modern republic has been founded. Mm-hmm. And the Turks is, of course, the defining factor of the new republic, but there were, of course, other ethnicities, mm-hmm. Which we witnessed in the first decades of the republic, that some exchanges with the Greeks, for instance. And then there were also some Armenian Christianity groups, and then some other ethnic groups in Turkey. So Atatürk wanted to create a peaceful country, and the motto, peace at home, peace in the world, was therefore very well embraced by all successive governments. But if you ask me the question, what was the defining moment or what is the greatest achievement? I guess the greatest achievement that we had all these years, more than 90 years, is that to portray the world that Turkey is a democratic, secular, social state governed by rule of law, mm-hmm. that Islam, democracy, and secularism are compatible. Mm-hmm. They don't need to fight each other. Mm-hmm. And it is quite possible, despite you are located in a turbulent area, to serve as an island of stability to the world peace.
Indeed, that's what you are doing at this time, in particular, really, as you said, turbulent time and turbulent district, in particular, the region. And I see the foreign policy of Turkey is kind of helping very, very in a greater way to make better the region. How do you find that?
Absolutely. I mean, first of all, the Turkish foreign policy based on many principles. Respect for independence and sovereignty of the countries, of the international community, good relations with domestic countries, with neighboring countries, non-intervention in domestic affairs, using the deep cultural and historical background of Turkey, dating back centuries ago, develop multi-beneficial relations, serving a bridge between East and West, Orient and Occident, having various features together. So Turkey is a Balkan, European, Asian, Caucasian, Middle Eastern, Mediterranean countries, all in the same time, which is very unique.
With Mongolia, it has a long, beyond diplomatic relations. We have monuments here in your language, and monuments, Kultigen, and how do you associate with this background, historic background yourself?
Absolutely. So the ties between both countries are very strong because the fundamental is strong. deep cultural and historical ties exist between both countries. So therefore, even today's modern relations are based on this solid foundation. Mongols and Turks were subjects of the big Hun Empire. So we are referring back to days thousands of years ago. I mean, definitely about 2,000 years ago. And most prominently, one of the early Turkic states were found on this soil. And the most prominent one is the Köktürks, which continued between 557 until 735. So in two different periods. And the monuments today, when you go to Harhorin, are referring to a dynasty, yes. Bilgekhan and Kültigin. Yes. And also when you go to Nalay, their vezir was Tonyukuk. Uh-huh. So these are the first inscriptions written maybe in runic alphabet, which we do not use today. However, the first time the word Turk goes on this stone inscriptions. Mm-hmm. So therefore it is very important to us. And there are messages even which could be applicable to today's politics. Mm-hmm. So therefore it is very crucial for us. Mm-hmm. And we have these strong ties. Of course, throughout centuries we were together. Mm-hmm. When after the great Genghis Empire, when we have this Mongol in four different states, mm-hmm. the Ilhanate states, mm-hmm. the center of which was today's Iran, had also some territory in today's Anatolia, mm-hmm. Amasya, Sivas, Kayseri, mm-hmm. where you built some schools, some hospitals, some bridges, some fountains, which are still to be seen and to be visited today.
See, don't you think that these historic backgrounds, say, from that fall time, the type of Mongolia was existing that time, and don't you think that these remainings, historical foundings in this country, could be a good reasons for Turkish people to visit Mongolia as tourists?
Absolutely, I fully agree with you. So therefore, I personally attach great importance to people-to-people contacts. As a matter of fact, one of my promises that I gave to President Elbegdorj during the presentation of the credential ceremony is to increase this feature of the relations. Mm-hmm. So this reminds me, of course, tourism. And tourism means service, quality service. So today's, if Turkey created a miracle in this field, so definitely behind lies the quality of the service, behind lies respect for foreigners and for tourism, but behind lies also hard work and dedicated work. Mm-hmm. So last year, Turkey was visited by 38 million foreigners.
38 million.
And there was a direct income of about $32 billion US mm-hmm. dollars today's budget. Wow. This is huge.
Almost $1,000 per each visitor on the average. I have been to your country several times. I indeed agree with the quality of services, not only in the big cities, but also in the remote areas, on the way, and a lot of things to see, good presentation in English. And what was the behind that boom of tourism? Was it any vision, or was it a particular policy? How you made it happen that well?
So, of course, this miracle has not been created in the last few years. That dates back to 1980s, during the former President Özal period, where Turkey has achieved a lot. Basically, the economy entered free market economy, and then there were a lot of privatization. There were special law, including promotion of investments, mm-hmm. as well as promotion of tourism. Special measures were taken by the coastal governance of Turkey. Mm-hmm. And of course, together with this, the image was very important because it was a problematic image of Turkey with regard to human rights, with regard to democracy. So parallel to this, we had to take also an important steps in the field of democracy. Mm-hmm. But when it comes to today's achievement, of course, I mean, Turkey get richer and richer, as I said, throughout this last 13, 14 years. The GDP has been tripled. The personal income now has reached almost 11,000 US dollars. Mm-hmm. And keep in mind that Turkey has a population of 77 million people. only Istanbul has 15 million, and the population of Istanbul alone is more than 122 countries in the world. So we are talking that kinds of sizes. Of course, Istanbul alone is not enough. We also made investment to the central Anatolia. Konya, for instance, the center of the Anatolian Seljuk Empire. Izmir, the third capital and the largest export harbor of Turkey. Antalya, of course, the pearl of Mediterranean, which has a population of 2 million, but receives every year 12 million foreigners to its borders.
A very tourism-friendly country.
So that these are the important facts. It did not happen
one day.
One day. So we needed to invest. We needed to go step by step. So this is, I guess, what Mongolia needs. So therefore, I very much was heartened that when Mongolia was chosen as the partner country this year, ITB Berlin, which was also partially sponsored by the Turkish Airlines, by the way, I'm proud to announce here. But this is just the beginning. When my friends asked me, everything is done, I said, nothing is done, to be very frank. This is just the beginning. And now the story, the nice journey of Mongolia starts from now on, I guess.
Цаг хугацаа давтагдчихгүй. Харин түүний яаж зөвшөглснөөр бидний амжилт хүтэл аз жаргал биднийг тагтдаг. Өөрийн хүний хувьд гэр бүл, уран бүтээлдээ зарцуулах цаг зөв зохицуулах хэрэгтэй гэдэг. Бидний хэрэглээ улам ухаалаг болсоор байгаа нь та бүхэнд харагдаж байна. Харин энэ бүхэн надад үнэхээр их таалагдчихэ.
Ухаалаг орон сууц. King Tower Apartment.
Exactly. I think also Turkish Airlines, being one of the largest now, airlines, and Istanbul being one of the busiest hubs in the world, I think a role of airline using your strategic location as important. And yet, Turkish Airlines, I have flown several times, but from Ulaanbaatar we have a 1 hour useless stop in Bishkek. What is that about? Why you don't fly it straight?
If it is 1 hour, you're lucky. Sometimes you have to witness, unfortunately, this stop 7 to 8 hours. This is the fact, which happened to me. Basically, when I was coming back from the in January from the recent annual ambassadorial conference,
why?
I mean, let me go through the MOU between both airlines has been signed in 2012, and then immediately since July 2012, Turkish Airlines started to operate direct flights between Istanbul and Ulaanbaatar. However, there is a limitation for passenger transportation, which was put by the Mongolian side, probably because of the national interest. To protect the national interest of Miat. To a certain level, maybe it could be understandable. But generally, if it will be at the expense of the commercial benefits and free travel rights, and basically develop or give a boost to economic and commercial relations, I have difficulties to understand this limitation.
So they asked you to fly.
So because of this, we cannot deploy large body aircraft. So if I'm not mistaken, please correct me, I guess the model which we deploy today, 3 times a week, this is the frequency, is the Boeing 737-800, which has a capacity of 150. So this basically limits only 3 times a week. So in order to make it more economic and feasible, so it makes a stopover in Bishkek, which is lose time, of course. Minimum 1 hour, the refueling happens in the Kyrgyz territory. So the money goes to the basically Kyrgyz Republic. Of course, in order to compensate, there are some passengers transportation between Bishkek and Ulaanbaatar, but which doesn't serve the purpose. First of all, the duration gets longer. Instead of 7, you fly 9 to 10 hours. Yeah. Instead of having more economic ticket, you pay more. Yeah. And instead of having this refueling money, another country wins this money.
And in to Istanbul, along with Turkish Airlines. Every airlines also can come.
Absolutely. So this is a competitive market. So airline sector, civil aviation sector. So if Miat wishes to fly, most welcome. So Miat flies some several countries, in the regional countries. Why not to Turkey? Okay. Definitely is most welcome. So but it is important.
These are the issues in tourism, bottlenecks in between two countries, as I see.
Yeah,
you have just
now
described it. Let's go back to education, where we have several schools. We have almost second generation is now coming out of school. You know, the graduates of those Turkish schools now are already propagated and married. Some of them continue their education in Turkey. Please tell us about this cooperation. What is the statistics beyond now?
Yes, I mean, if you ask me the question, what is the strongest link between both countries, without hesitation, I will tell you education. Since 1992, Turkish government decided to provide scholarships to Mongolian students. The first graduates from Turkish university, they came in 1997, and since then, back, we have about 3,000 Turkish graduates in the country. They're not only in Ulaanbaatar, they're in various provinces. They're not only for public sector, but for private sector. They really are genuine ambassadors. I'm proud of them. I'm in frequent contact with them through social media or in person. And some of them went back to Turkey. Currently in Turkey, there are 900 Mongolian students, and nearly half of them have been receiving the Turkish scholarship. And they study in various provinces, they study at various universities, and they study in almost every discipline, from engineer to journalism, from history to medicine. They're very successful students. I am very proud of them. So therefore, this linkage is quite important. So I hope that in the future, this feature of the relationship will be more and more promoted. When it comes to, for instance, Mongolian language and history in Turkey, I am proud to announce that one of the prominent universities, Hacettepe University, just opened up a special section. Likewise, I'm also very proud that there are about 40 students which study at MUIS, at the Turkology Department, with whom I am in frequent contact, and then they do speak Turkish. Even in the National Day, in the October 29, they sang the Turkish National Anthem. So I'm very proud of them.
You know, I have seen you recently with your coming. You are 1.5 years in the country.
Exactly.
I haven't seen some Turkish fashion show here. Quite different developments. Why?
Why? Because culture is everything. Despite this huge historical and cultural background, I cannot tell confidently that both nations do know each other. I am very impressed when my plane landed here in October 15, 2013, because I was dreaming a different country. But Ulaanbaatar was quite a civilized city, huge, 1.5 million. Everywhere was construction. I came here, I question myself whether I ended up in a wrong country. Day by day, I learned new about the deep culture and traditions of this great country. So therefore, I travel a lot within the country. I'm in frequent contact in every segment of the Mongolian society. But Mongolian culture must be more promoted in Turkey. This is one of the most crucial things.
What kind of things?
What kind of things? Maybe this cultural year of Mongolia in Turkey, or some concerts could be given, or some exhibitions could be opened, some exchanges with NGOs or journalists more and more could be done. And like as I did last year, a Turkish fashion show here in Ulaanbaatar, a Mongolian fashion show in Turkey could be also very useful. So there are various parameters. So if you are able to bring them together, which is basically our terms of reference, then I guess that you're satisfied.
Indeed, you're doing wonderful jobs in cultural sector. How about business, investment?
That's a very good question. Again, I mean, to be very honest, I am not saying that we can tap the good potential of both countries. Total economic figure was last year tantamount to $35 million, which is nothing.
I admit that,
which is basically nothing. But the target for 2015 is $250 million, which was put by our political leaders during the visit of President Erdogan, who came here with the title of Prime Minister in April 2013. That was put with his counterpart. For this, we need to work more. For this, we need to make known more the Mongolian market, the opportunities, the untapped opportunities of Mongolia, not only in mining, because mining more or less known, there are some debatable issues, but agriculture, animal husbandry, leather processing, tourism, or jewelry. So these are basically the sectors, or construction, of course, that Turkish private sector can create a difference, can make a difference in the living quality of this country. Mm-hmm. So I do encourage Turkish businessmen, especially in these sectors.
What can we do better to attract more investors from Turkey to Mongolia?
Again, I'm going to back, we need to work hard. We should not take anything taken for granted.
Yeah, what are the major concerns that businesses sharing with you?
I see. So, first of all, there are advantages and disadvantages. The biggest advantage is this is a democratic country. This is a free country. Free market economy rules. And there are great potentials that I mentioned. When it comes to disadvantages is, of course, to be very frankly, a fragile governmental system. Governments change very frequently. Secondly, well, governments can change, but not necessarily the bureaucratic cadres should change. They do change as well, which is
structure-wise, people-wise,
absolutely
keep changing.
Secondly,
every second, yeah.
The logistics. Thirdly, the climate. They are not unachievable obstacles. So we can achieve these obstacles. There must be goodwill, and there must be hard work and education. So besides government, private sectors must come together more frequently and have B2B talks. Civil society organizations must come together, and governments must be basically taking necessary measures to promote these relations. Of course, airline is one of them, and most important them. Some rules and regulations, and some business mentality. To be very frankly, we had also some bitter experiences in the field of construction in last year in this respect. So we need to overcome these bitter experiences as well.
Indeed, that's probably your job, our government job, to be more, to create more business-friendly environment.
Yes.
And plus, there is nothing that is not possible. It's just a matter of better governance,
absolutely,
stability,
yes,
predictability for
yes
businesses.
Exactly.
I would like to ask you a few personal questions.
Sure.
You studied at the State University of New York.
Yes.
You made master there, and before in Turkey. And you have been, as a young diplomat, also posted to NATO.
Yes.
Secretary office in Belgium, right?
Yes. In Turkish permanent mission to NATO.
And then now Turkey is the largest army in NATO.
Second largest, after the United States.
After U.S. And if there is any relations in this sense between Mongolia and Turkey?
Yes,
this
is important. You touched upon a very nice point. Our embassy, in fact, throughout 2015 and 16, has been chosen as the NATO point of contact embassy.
I see.
To this end, I paid a visit, very short visit, in February to headquarters. Mm-hmm. And basically we discussed, together with many other partner countries, what could be done. NATO is partner across the globe of NATO. From this region, I guess, Japan, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, these are other partner countries.
Partner countries.
So Mongolia from the Asia-Pacific region, basically, Mongolia is another country. Mongolia has every reason to be proud of, to contribute to the international peace and security.
That's the whole thing.
Absolutely.
Otherwise, the military itself has not that much.
Maybe, despite the fact that we have robust military and defense relations between both countries. So therefore, I guess that it is important to make known the modern notion of NATO. Yes. Because NATO is not only defense organization. It is more than that. It is a community of democratic nations. And together with partners, we try to create a better environment and to discuss the modalities, how to contribute more to the international peace. So to this end, I guess that Mongolia has an asset.
What is I have seen your career, relatively compared to many other countries, young ambassador, plenipotentiary, extraordinary ambassador. What does it take to be, to make such a career? I mean, I just ask you the question on behalf of many young people, maybe who wants to have some good career like you. How much is it? What kind of character trait do you think is important?
First of all, thank you very much. These are the compliments I guess I don't deserve that much. It's very kind of you to hear this, such a good friend and intellectual, a real intellectual of Mongolia. Well, from the very young ages, I was interested in politics. Throughout gymnasium, I mean high school, I was always reading and discussing its political matters within the family. There is no politician in my family. I don't have any siblings. I'm a single child, by the way. I had a very intellectual grandfather with whom we used to discuss for many years all these old political issues. So since I learned also foreign language and...
You speak German, English,
right? And a little bit Bulgarian, yes. Mm-hmm. So then I decided to bring these qualities maybe with the diplomacy. So right after the university, although throughout universities I also worked in the field of tourism as professional tour guide.
I see.
Right after that, I entered the exam of the foreign ministry and I got the exam. I'm happy. I'm happy because I'm doing a job that I desired. And I'm also happy to serve in such a beautiful country like Mongolia and get acquainted with friends and brothers with different culture, similar traditions, and try to contribute to the better future of both countries.
It's so important to have a job that you like very much, you dream about.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ambassador.
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's very kind of you. Thank you.
Сахнтуштэ өнөдөр манай де факто нэвтрүүлгийн зочноор бүгд найрамдах түүх хүнсийн улсаас Монгол улсад цугаан анц бүгд бүрэн ирэхэд элчин сайд ноён Каракош оролцлоо. Баярлалаа.
Монголд анх удаа ухаалаг гар утсыг үн төлбөргүй авах урамшууллыг Mobicom дараа төлбөрт Signature вакцин хэрэглэгчдэд санал болгож байна. Та 7-р сарын 9-ний өдрийг хүртэл өөр тойр байрлах Mobicom-ийн салбар дээр хүрэлцэн ирж, үйлчлэгээний гэрээтэйгээр сүүлийн үеийн ухаалаг гар утсыг үнэгүй болон онцгой хөнгөлөлттэй үнээр аваарай. Бидэнтэй хамт байсан хэрэглэгч танд баярлалаа. Mobicom.